Welcome to the show known as Conversations in Monrovia. You see, I'm donning some specs because reading is rather difficult now. The hottest thing going on right now is freedom of speech in more ways than one. Didn't Kanye West set out a fire cake when he made the statement that slavery was an option, a great job opportunity? Before we get started with that, I'm honored to have here in the studio Adam Papagan?
Yes, close enough. Yeah, Papagan.
What is it correctly?
Papagan? Yeah, but I know what you're saying.
Okay. Well, I want the viewers to know too now.
Okay, yeah. Well, they can put two and two together.
Now you are a producer?
Yeah, I've been doing public access for many years. That's how I came here to Monrovia. I actually live in Santa Monica, but the unity of public access, you know, the having the back of another public access producer, it's something that I've always really liked. So when I heard I could get to be on your show, Ralph, I, you know, jumped at the opportunity.
All right, so you're also a tour guide?
That's right. You know, you got to have a day job. I'm a tour guide. I own and operate a tour company called Cool LA Tours.
And name some of the great tours that you...
Yeah, we do the Hollywood Boulevard walking tour of kind of like the unusual things, you know, that most tourists would miss out on.
What would be something unusual?
Oh, well, there's a great bar called the Snow White Cafe that is decorated with real Disney stuff that Walt Disney gave permission for this guy to use like 9 years before Disneyland opened.
Okay.
So it's real actual Disney artifacts, but that Disney doesn't own. So it's like kept away from their like narrative of like them owning their history. So it's just like a cool little thing. And it's a dive bar, you know.
Oh,
there's never anybody in there.
And what's
stuff
the name
like that.
Of the,
Snow White Cafe.
And it's off the beaten path? Or?
No, it's on Hollywood and Highland. But you just walk by it because there's
so much
else going on.
You wouldn't think Disney stuff would be inside a place like this.
Exactly.
What's another... Part of a tour that's interesting.
Now, the O.J. Simpson tour is definitely my highest profile tour. I grew up in the West L.A. area, so I was going to elementary school in Brentwood when it was all happening. I went to school a block from the murder scene. So I've always been interested in the O.J. trial. And one thing has kind of led to another, and I have a Ford Bronco, and we go around Brentwood. We go to the different sites, you know, related to the story. I kind of tell my own personal remembrances of what I remember from
the 90s. You book many people for that tour?
Yeah.
People still...
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
From all over the world, probably, huh?
More and more, but mostly Americans. But I have actually, last October, I got an email from a school teacher from Denmark who was like, hey, I'm taking my students on an international field trip. We're going to go to California. We're going to go to Silicon Valley. We're going to go to the missions. We're going to go to Alcatraz. And we want to go on the OJ tour. So I had to charter a bus, and I took these 30 Danish teenagers on the OJ tour. Because they actually learn about the OJ trial in school and
so
other countries.
So how do you start it off, in a sense? Give the viewers out there a little... You're driving up to the...
The elementary school. The middle school. Paul River Middle School. Which is where there was a dance recital the night of the murders, and OJ and Nicole kind of got into like a little fight.
Mm-hmm.
So her and her parents and her sisters went off to dinner at the Mezzaluna restaurant where Ron Goldman worked. And then OJ went home, and this is kind of the events leading up to him leaving town that night to fly to Chicago for the Celebrity Golf Tournament.
So what's your take on OJ and the whole scenario?
Whether I think he did it or not?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that he did it, but...
By himself?
Yeah. I just don't know, because, like, it's like a conspiracy or, like, some, like, new information. It's the idea of that is just so alluring and sexy, but the reality of it is this is a domestic violence situation. That's who gets murdered. It's, like, people by their husbands or by their wives. Like, that's most murders are, like, a bad relationship. And so if you just look at it... In just kind of plain terms, without all the celebrity aspects and the trial being on TV and the racial components and the LA riots before that and all that stuff. If you just look at it, it's like, yeah, he probably did it. But what I've learned from doing this is some people think that he did it, some people think that he didn't do it.
Right.
Everyone has an opinion, and that is what is so significant.
So what's your take on, have you met any of the... prime players
no,
in this scenario?
They're hard to meet because they're not like mainstream celebrities. They're not like doing appearances and stuff. They're like book signings and stuff. I've tried to meet Marsha Clark. I've met some side people. I met the woman who saw OJ leaving the crime scene, but sold her story to Hard Copy, so she never testified during the trial. And then I've met the guy who ghost wrote OJ's hypothetical confession, if I did it. The guy who like wrote it with him.
Okay. What about Johnny Cochran? Well, he's passed.
Yeah, he died, what, 2004, I think?
Yeah.
Yeah, so now...
Is he part of the tour in any way?
You know, I actually don't really touch on the trial part of it.
Okay.
Right at the end, I'm just like, yeah, and then the Dream Team came in, and Johnny Cochran had the strategy and stuff. But the part I'm, like, interested in showing people is just, like, the reality of, like, what Brentwood looks like. It's this lame neighborhood.
Okay.
It pretty much looks, and, like, these were the circumstances that led off. Like, you know about the trial. You watched it on TV. Mm-hmm. Like, that's been covered a million times.
What's the population of Brentwood?
Ooh, good question. 2,000 people, maybe? I'll look it up. Because it's a neighborhood. It's just a little part of L.A.,
okay.
Yeah.
Wow, I've always thought it was something a little bit bigger.
No, it's just, like, it's in between the 405 freeway, where, you know, the Chase, and, like, mm-hmm. that's part of it, you know, but, and then, like, Santa Monica is to the west. So it's really maybe only, like, the whole tour is round trip, 5 miles of the neighborhood.
You're
yeah.
in and out the neighborhood.
Yeah. It's 5 miles to the meetup from the garage to the meetup location, and then 5 through Brentwood, and then, you know, 5 miles.
All right, what's another interesting tour you have, Adam?
I do one with another guy, through a company I work for called Atlas Obscura, that's like the Disneyland Secrets. So we go into Disneyland.
What's the Disneyland Secret?
The secret menu items at the restaurants. The little hidden stuff that, like, Walt Disney, like, left, like, little clues and stuff. A lot of people have died at Disneyland. Disneyland is actually the deadliest theme park. 10 people have died there.
From the rides or the food or what?
From the rides. It's mainly that river, the Rivers of America.
Yeah.
Water is dangerous. You could drown in it.
Yeah.
You know, it's what, so there's been a few drownings. People have gotten injured on rides. So it's stuff like that. And then also little hidden fun stuff.
What about room 331?
Oh, Club 33.
Club 33.
Where you have to, that's the only place at Disneyland where they serve alcohol, and there's a really long waiting list. And a friend of mine actually met a woman who worked at Disneyland for like 30 years,
mm-hmm.
so she now has this like pass. She can get me into Disneyland pretty much any time for free,
mm-hmm.
But she's been to Club 33 like a billion times. She's like, it's not so great. But people like to talk about Disneyland, even if it's stuff they already know.
What's another secret?
Another secret, all the plants at Tomorrowland are edible.
Are you serious?
Yeah, it's lettuce. Then they're not going to maybe taste very good, but you could pull up a leaf and put it in your mouth. And I do that during the tour, and it's
Why is it that way?
Because it's supposed to be like the future.
Oh, and everything is okay.
Wouldn't that make more sense in the future to have plants we could eat as opposed to, I mean, maybe not.
Yeah, something looking and sucking up water.
Yeah.
It would be better to have something that you could eat.
Maybe, maybe not. But in the, it's like that whole like, 50s, like post-war, like optimistic mentality that Disneyland was founded on.
Okay. Do you like Disneyland?
Love it.
Why?
It's so weird. That this guy who's like at the top of the media, he's got a movie company, he's got TV shows, he's got Disney Records, was like, people forget that, but they had like children's music and stuff that they would put out. He was like the king of the media, and he was still like, hey, I need this Abraham Lincoln robot. And I need it today, and we need to get this to the World's Fair. Come on. Like, and he wanted to, like, go to the moon. Like, his vision was crazy. It seems nuts.
Especially at that particular time.
Yeah. Do you know how many people around Hollywood must have been like, Walt's lost it. What is he thinking? He bought all these orange groves out there?
Way out in Anaheim. Yeah.
And yet, it's the most popular thing. People love it. They spend all their money there. Yeah. It caught on, like, so hard.
And maintained.
And maintain.
It didn't like just catch on and then all of a sudden sort of, I mean, it has.
It's had its moment, ups and downs, yeah.
But it's perpetuated joy and happiness to a lot of folks.
But also, like, this in this very, like, regimented, like, one mind, like, you know, kind of way that is, like, a little just, like, overbearing and authoritarian. But it's mostly for fun and it's for kids. So you shouldn't read too much into it.
Okay, it's primarily for kids.
It's for kids.
First and foremost.
Yeah.
That never grow up
Yeah.
sense of reality in a funny kind of a way, I guess.
Or also, like, just for people who are children now to, like, go see, like... Like, that's, like, who it's for. Like, there's a lot of, like, adults without children who have season passes and they
Right. And they find a sense of joy just being there.
Yeah. Because you see the kids, like, actually get excited about it and, like, that's what it's really all about. Like, that's the magic of the Magic Kingdom.
Now, you have a favorite ride, a section for you that you could really enjoy?
At California Adventure, which is a whole other thing. I'm working on a California Adventure tour right now. I'm trying to think of the angle on it. But there's the movie Cars has a ride.
Oh, yes.
And it's a scenic ride at first. And then it's a dark ride. It goes in and there's the animatronics. And then it's a roller coaster at the end.
Oh,
so it's all three types of ride.
Oh, okay.
So that's my favorite. I also love Mr. Toad's Wild Ride from Disneyland.
Okay.
Because it's about drunk driving and going to hell.
Are you serious?
Yeah. You don't, like, pick up on it. Yeah, Mr. Toad's, like, this, like, aristocratic, like, frog, you know, whatever, in England. And he's drinking a lot, and he's driving this old car, and he crashes. And then there's the part with the judge, and he's like, guilty! And then you go into hell, and it's hot. That's my favorite part, because it's memorable. It's like a temperature thing. And then the ride's over.
Okay. My wife, when we arrived from Chicago, and we're living in Pasadena, she was amazed with It's a Small World.
She
used to love that so much that she would take the bus from Pasadena with three small kids to go to Disneyland. I couldn't believe it because that was one long bus ride. It was like, you got to be kidding. You love it that much? And she would do it.
People, it's fun. And it's a part of being from Southern California is having this access to Disneyland. You're not trying to fit everything in because you can go a lot and you can really appreciate the nuances of it.
All right, because you could take certain sections where you just want to be in.
Yeah, you don't have to do everything, especially getting it for free. Like, I have this hookup. You go on three rides, eat lunch, go home. Like, it's like, you like, it takes on this thing as it's like a place you can go, just like you would go to the mall or you would go to the public access.
Okay.
But it's like all like fake.
You know your spot.
Yeah.
All right, tell me something from the secret menu.
There's a burger at the burger place in Tomorrowland. If you get it alien style, it's like animal style from In-N-Out.
Okay.
And they put the grilled onions. It's not as good as In-N-Out.
Okay, of course not.
And they upcharge you, of course.
You're paying for it.
You're paying for that extra cheese and
you
onions.
Really are alien, okay? So you better have a big wallet. All right, to the viewers out here, I have Adam here on the show where the subject is bouncing around. He's a tour guide and a producer, and he has an interesting spin on next subject is freedom of speech. Kanye West let out some mean tweets, which has set maybe the world on fire in some ways, and in particular United States, especially when you talk about the history of slavery in America, that took it from the British and really perfected it in more ways than one of torture and mayhem. What's your take on Kanye?
Well,
I jump too far?
Okay, well, I want to get your take on this, actually. Do you think he's on drugs?
Yes.
I do, too. I think that he's on opioids.
Yes.
And it makes you crazy. He even said in that interview that he's, like, on opioids from liposuction.
I take them, but I'm supposed to take three, but now I take one.
That's what an addict would say. The Kardashians are enablers. Remember Lamar Odom almost overdosed?
Yes.
Like, they're not going to say anything. They don't have his best interests in mind. So I think that this is a combination of this being...
Wait a minute. You don't think they love Kanye?
I think they love him, but they're not going to be like, hey, you need to get off these drugs. Like, I think that they're enablers.
Okay.
Because of maybe something else in one of their... Something about their family that we don't know. I don't know. But I think that you know, you don't see a lot of people in the Kardashian family, like, in recovery, like, talking about it. Where you look at, like, the rest of the entertainment industry and, like, a lot of celebrities have been through it. So I think that there may be... I think that he has some drug issues.
Mm-hmm.
Like, remember Anna Nicole and everyone was oh, she's so crazy. And then she overdosed on pills.
Right.
Britney Spears. Oh, she's crazy. She's shaving her head. She's
former
crazy.
Disney child.
Yeah, right? Hey, it's not perfect.
Okay.
But she was on pills, right? So
right.
I think that he's on pills. And he's also not maybe that bright of a guy to begin with. He's super talented, and that's like a weight on him that like affects your perception of things. And he has a new album coming out, and he's trying to get into the media to rile people up. So he's been given this tremendous platform and doesn't really have the tools to maybe navigate that in an eloquent way. So some of the things he said are like not like defensible. I will defend his right to say them, but I'm not going to be like, if you want to know what he meant by that slavery thing, you should talk to Mr. West yourself.
Well, he's tried to explain it,
and but he hasn't really been able to.
No, he's been trying to backtrack off of it. Like, I made everyone so upset.
Yeah,
but I'm not saying I learned something from my statement.
Yeah,
because he doesn't read books. At least right. He makes that statement. He definitely doesn't read.
Look in his eyes. Like, this is a confused guy. The eyes are the window to the soul. Like, this is a. And you know what he looks like. Look at his eyes.
I wanted a camera close-up to look into his eyes.
You know what Kanye was. Look at his eyes anytime. This is a guy who's like...
zoned out.
But the wheels are turning inside. You can see in his brain, like, the wheels are turning. And who knows what he's going to think of next. He's a genius, after all.
He's a genius, but he's sick.
Yeah, he's not a smart guy. However...
Hitler was considered a genius, too.
Yeah, but maybe a military, he's like a musical genius.
Okay.
Yeah, which is a specific kind of genius.
Okay, well, some people thought Hitler was a political genius. Or military.
At the time, and then, how does history treat that now? They're like, oh, that's the worst guy.
Well, some people still hold on to that.
Yeah, like hate-filled, like crazy people. But like, some people are crazy. What are you going to do, Ralph?
No, I've heard some, quote, normal people said, well, he built roads in Germany and the Volkswagen.
Anybody can build a road or a car.
Okay, that's not my beliefs.
Yeah, right?
Okay, first and foremost. But, so Kanye... You're saying there's so many different factors about why he's doing what he's doing.
Mm-hmm.
First, we established that he's sick.
I think it's a drug thing. Yeah, mm-hmm. I do. Like, it's definitely influencing this.
Now, do you think the whole TMZ thing was like a perfect little platform for him to use that ill-fated statement about slavery? To pimp slavery to sell his records.
See, what if he had said mass incarceration instead? Mm-hmm. Well, mass incarceration seems like a choice. Well, then that could be interpreted as like, oh yeah, you know, we need to elevate ourselves and follow the laws, even if the system is gained against us or whatever. And people might be applauding him. Or some people might be saying, it's not a choice. There are, institutional things about our society that, make it so that more black men go to jail and
it's well, it's documented. It's a fact.
Right, exactly. But it's not as emotionally raw as slavery, maybe, or it's not as ingrained in like our history as slavery and stuff. So if he had used a different analogy, it still would have not been great.
Well, that's a game of semantics then.
Yeah. But
say this, but don't say that.
But because of who he is saying it, it'd be different if you or I said it. Because, like, we're trying to be credible, like, on this TV show. I'm a tour guy. I have to know what I'm talking about or whatever.
Right, right.
And if I was like, yeah, so, that was Walt Disney's apartment that he had above the Matterhorn. By the way, slavery was a choice. Like, that would be nuts. You'd be like, what are you talking about? But if this guy says it, who everyone's like, oh, he knows something we don't, whatever, then that's why the debate comes. It's because, like, wait, he could be so smart in one other area, but this goes against that. Because it seems so, like, an off-base weird thing to say.
It seems like?
Well, like...
It is off-base.
It's illogical that somebody would say something like that if they were also this person who had such a calculated image.
I would say...
You know what I mean?
Especially for a black person.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, you got a few erratic white folks that might go out on a crazy limb and rush Limbaugh.
Yeah.
Somebody like that will make a statement that's like totally ridiculous.
But it's expected when they say it.
Yes.
When a black guy says it who's in hip hop.
Right.
Oh, why did he say that? And probably because he's crazy and he wants publicity and he wants controversy and stuff.
Or just sick. But But we're back to six.
Yeah, he's...
We're back. Yeah. And then to me, it's like, whoever his doctor is, he got the wrong damn doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's just getting money from it.
Yeah.
Or maybe you think he knows some secrets on the Kardashian family and they got him so in that zone, the deep hole, as in get out.
Yeah.
How do you
they swallow people whole. Yeah,
especially
family.
Black men in particular.
That's what they say.
That's what you see.
Well, maybe they just are attracted to people who have a lot of chaos in their relationships are gonna not work out anyway.
Well,
however, it does seem like they all have a type.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like a definite type.
And then you wonder, how do they maintain control of the media all over the world?
Is it all over the world?
Yeah, Kardashians.
The world?
Everybody wants Kardashians. Is like, everybody wants that show. Everybody wants to see them or hear what Kim is wearing or what she's doing. Mm-hmm. This is a woman with, what, three kids or two? How many kids?
I think they have two kids.
Two kids?
Yeah.
And she's always flashing her body? Is that mommy? Who the hell is that? What?
I mean,
if you got it, flash it, but come on, when do you stop?
They seem to know some sort of pact with the devil, something where they understand how to use the media.
Well, we know America's hooked on sex.
Yeah.
Whether it's directly or indirectly.
Yeah.
They tell you in advertisement, they find a way to put it in, even though, well, what did I just say? They find a way to put it in. I'll leave that to you. Okay. But they control the media. But what do they really do?
They are in the media. What they do is they dish out a little bit of their personality, a little bit of their entertainment, one tweet at a time, one picture at a time. So you think about it, if you're like a filmmaker and you're making like this great film, you're like a musician, you're making this album, like that's your like cohesive work, that's your statement. This new distribution model for entertainment, it's a little bit at a time. It's just a little, it's like micro dosing of the entertainment. And you just get like a little like dopamine thing in your brain, like, there's her kid.
Initially they got you.
Yeah.
And so now here's a little drip.
And then you watch, you know, 20, they've been around what, 10 years now, another 10, 20 years. They're going to have stars on the Walk of Fame and they're going to be like memorable celebrities because they've gotten into the consciousness. Now, what bothers me about them is there are people like that who are immensely talented. Like Elvis Presley, Michael Jackson are like in the consciousness.
Right.
And we got great music out of it that we can still enjoy.
What are we getting out of them?
Nothing. A sex tape.
Yes. Promoted by mom.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm saying. There are boundary issues within this family that would maybe prevent one of them from being like, and maybe, you know, it's a weird thing because like their relationship is, you know, it's hard to tell somebody you love, you're in a relationship with, like, hey, you need to stop this behavior. It's killing you, you know.
Especially when you're making money.
Yeah, right. And everyone you're around is just like always laughing at your jokes and telling you how great you are, and you can never go anywhere normal.
Surrounded by the yes men. People, mm-hmm. the yes squad.
Yes moms.
Who is the youngest Kardashian?
There's those two with Bruce Jenner, Kylie and Kendall.
So they're going to be milking this train for a while, huh?
And they all have another generation now coming up.
That's right, huh?
And who is their father? OJ's lawyer, Robert Kardashian.
They weave the connection.
Kanye West met his wife because of the OJ trial.
That's how it happened?
Well, you could work the way back. She wouldn't have been famous.
Right.
Without this. Because she was friends with Paris Hilton.
Oh, yes.
That was how it started. Who, Paris Hilton does even less than the Kardashians. I'm glad she kind of went away.
Yeah, she's sort of like, I had enough of this now.
Yeah, it's classy. She kind of bowed out.
But I thought Kim would have changed when that break-in in France took place.
It's out of control. Like, they're not on the same planet as we are, Ralph. They're in, like, celebrity, crazy money. Like, nothing is real to them.
So then we're back to Kanye Get Out Part 2. Mm-hmm. He's in the black hole.
He's in the hole, you think? Of the Kardashians?
Yeah.
In this analogy?
Okay. Oh, yes.
Ooh. All right.
Ooh, and he's stirring his tea, and he's lost his mother, and Kim's mom is like his mom, but I don't know if she steered him in what direction, but somehow she has a hold on it.
Yeah. Ooh, this is a great analogy.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, and Kim is the, I don't know if she can, I don't know where to put Kim in this, but.
Is Allison Williams.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, then who are the gardener and the maid?
The gardener and the maid are probably the yes people that work somewhere within the house that gets the extra drugs for Kanye and Kim. You know, like, hey, I feel like I need a joint or something. Mm-hmm. All right, this guy's going to run out and get it. I don't know what's happening. Uh-huh. But didn't he just recently fire someone that used to work closely with him?
I believe so, yeah. And that might have been a situation of like, hey, I'm going to take these drugs away from you. That's what happened. Elvis was going to fire the colonel because the colonel was going to finally step in and like, he didn't know what to do either.
I got to stop this here.
Yeah, but they were saying they're making so much money, you know, and their livelihood and their legend was all tied up into this. It's hard to like stop with the drugs.
If I take his drugs away, it's got to be a period of time where he can't perform.
Yeah, and then what's the public going to think? Elvis, this all-American boy, and then he's on drugs, and it's going to ruin. Because the colonel's really paranoid all the time about, like, it all coming crashing down. Because he got a 50% cut
from Elvis. Oh, my
God. Yeah.
He laughed all the way to the bank.
And you know why Elvis never performed outside of the United States?
Why?
The colonel said he was like, Elvis is an American artist. It wouldn't be right for him to, you know, go out there. He needs to keep it in America. But actually, the colonel was from the Netherlands. He wasn't a U.S. citizen. And if he left the country, he would have issues getting back in because he didn't have a passport.
Mm.
So it's very complicated, these things. Like, the Kanye West is like the person in front, but there's all these other factors behind these people and these just taking, get-outing them.
Is the gravy train.
Yeah. And then so it's probably stressful, and then you say some dumb stuff on TMZ, which itself is a heightened, weird environment.
Yes. And they look for that.
Yeah.
They love that. Mm-hmm. Ratings, everything. I mean, and then the guy that Kanye fired that was supposed to have been very close to him end up going with the guy that plays basketball, Christian Thomas. He's dating one of the Kardashians. He ended up working with him. So it's like, did he go after another person to put into the whole Christian Thomas? I mean,
ooh.
I'm like, this is crazy, because I think LeBron told him, don't bring that up in here. Like, don't even bring her around.
Mm-hmm.
All right, she just recently had a baby by him.
Yeah, it gets confusing, but you can see it's fun to talk about and speculate. You can see why.
No, it's sad because you got young people that are, this is a lot of young people's hero. Kanye impacted
young them. People though, because he's older. He's 40. He's been around for 10 years.
But there's people that loved him. I mean, the guy on TMZ that called him out.
Yeah. That's like his high school music. Yeah. Was like Kanye. Yeah.
Yes. And then all of a sudden, you're loving Trump? I mean.
Okay. So that is purely concocted. Like, pops a pill. What would be the craziest thing I could do in the media? Because I'm a genius, you know? Whatever they do. Like, this is how Kanye is thinking. What's the craziest thing? Oh, I know. I should just go meet up with this Trump guy everybody hates. But I think it's totally calculated.
But he always liked Trump. I think he did. I think from behind the scene business deals and whatnot, Trump has a lot of...
He's a lot of people, delusional people.
Trump has a lot of influence on people in the media world or the entertainment world, because he owns a lot of stuff behind the scenes that we might not like have a clue. Like when he became president, everybody had to show up and kiss the ring, take the elevator ride up. One person comes to mind to me, maybe it's Steve Harvey. If you want to keep your TV show, if you want to announce Miss World or whatever.
You think Trump and Steve Harvey are in cahoots?
I mean, I think they're business friends. People don't like to lose money.
Howard Stern and Trump are friends.
People don't like to lose money. Once they up there in that thing, they'll take a little. Now, Steve Harvey was supposed to talk to him, and what changes came about? I don't know. Now they got stats out that black men in particular like Trump. Nobody asked me to give my opinion, but the political world is something else. But behind the scene, there's a lot of things that go on that Joe and Mrs. Average don't have a clue that connection.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because what was it? The Apprentice was what, on NBC?
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure Donald Trump is probably friends with Bill Cosby.
Yeah, Trump will be friends with anyone, though.
Well, it's about money.
Yeah, it's about money and like,
if you're in
ego.
That wealthy club,
yeah,
you know,
mm-hmm.
you're in that wealthy club, I ain't talking about chump change, I'm talking about some money, even mm-hmm. though they say Trump don't have as much money as he...
Oh, yeah, he's broke.
As he claimed.
Yeah.
Putin don't got all his money.
Yeah.
That's who controls mm-hmm. him, but we don't know yet because I'm pretty sure that would be so damaging for the office of the president for something like that really to be true.
He's going down. The Russia investigation?
You think so?
2019. Look out for it, Ralph.
You think so?
2019 is the year. All this is going to... Because, like, every, like, decade, and maybe not exactly 10 years, every, like, you know, 10 to 12 years, it seems mm-hmm. like everything from the past 10 years kind of comes to a head and boils over. And so when was the financial crisis? That was like 8 years ago at this point.
Oh,
it was
yes.
a while ago.
Right.
And that's what started this. Everyone's like, hey, I'm not getting a fair shake. Hey, I don't have the American dream. Hey, my wages aren't. Hey, what's up with the 1%? Yeah. Remember Occupy movement?
Yeah.
That's the first time I ever heard about them.
Right.
And now everyone knows. It's like, oh, I don't F those guys. You know,
yeah.
like they have all the money. So obviously nothing's going to change drastically. Like they're still going to have all the money. But there's going to be some... The Russia investigation, I think, is going to be like, it's going to make like the 2016 election look like the OJ trial.
You think it's going to blow it open?
Yeah, I think it's going to be, I think it's some good
stuff. You think people care?
Well, could picture this. He goes down and he's still the president the whole time and he like goes to jail. And he's, like, in the orange jumpsuit, and he's still president. He's, like, behind the desk, and there's, like, bars on the, like, Oval Office. Couldn't you imagine that?
No, I can't.
See, I think it, like, could lead to that point where it's, like, it's going to get so crazy. It's like a movie.
Because
of these laws that are, like, the president is, like, immune to all these laws. Because
right.
they're, like, oh, no, a guy this crazy would never get elected.
Yeah, but look what happened.
Yeah, and it finally happened. This Manchurian Candidate, and there's that movie with Robin Williams where he runs for president. He's like a talk show host. There's a lot of things
oh,
like
yes,
this.
Oh, yes, they already put out there.
Idiocracy, do you know that movie?
No.
It's Mike Judge, the creator of King of the Hill and Beavis and Butthead, made it like
that was a, that
10
was
years
a,
ago.
That was a bunch of character, Beavis and Butthead. Didn't I have to pull that off TV?
Maybe.
Yeah, because it was so far out there.
It was just some potty humor and stuff.
Yeah.
But, but he made this movie about this future where, like, the planet was dying because everyone was so stupid. They were watering crops with Gatorade. And, like, it was like, a really, like, depressing look at the future.
Yeah.
But the president was a professional wrestler. And Trump is in the WWF. He would do all this stuff. Like, it actually happened.
Where are we headed in this world?
It's got to go back the other way.
What's going to swing the pendulum to go the other way? Because I don't know what your political alliance is, but mm-hmm. to me, there's only one party in America, and that's the party of the wealthy.
Yeah.
And if you're not making $90,000 a year by yourself, you don't really have a voice. You think that you do,
mm-hmm.
but if your mind is clouded with racism and nationalism and you're on the deep end, you might think you got a voice and remember Drain the Swamp?
Mm-hmm.
It was like, it seemed like it's feed the swamp, right?
Yeah. Swamp creatures.
So, where is America at?
Where are we at?
Yeah, because, you know, the Supreme Court has been stacked and tilted one way and...
Well, so the thing, there's many problems, I think, with Donald Trump being the president. But one thing that is very bad long-term is that he's installing all of these judges and a lot of his policies he have made are very conservative.
Yes.
and counter to what is better for the majority of people, especially in changing times, like being reactionary like that. So those long-term effects, I think, are maybe something more to watch out for. So I don't know. I'm hoping Jerry Brown's going to run for president. I think he might be able to take Trump down. He's a heck of an entertainer, though, so he could win the second term, and then we're really going to be screwed. But unpopular presidents are always, like, they're always, like, before, like, some big cultural change happens.
Mm-hmm.
So we might be almost through all this nonsense, or this could just be the beginning of the end.
I would think the beginning of the end.
Yeah.
Because it's not just the president. Look at the senators, the governors, and representatives. It's like we've had such a withdrawal of people from the political spectrum.
Nobody wants these jobs.
Don't want to be bothered. And then your past, if you got one ink on your shirt.
Yeah, exactly.
You're in trouble.
Because the media will just, who wants that investigation into their life? The fundraising and all this stuff.
What's your take on the media? Have they been doing their part? Printed media, radio, and then the media has
changed. The media is entertainment. News is entertainment. So,
but it wasn't always entertainment. It used to be fact-finding, and that was the forefront.
But still, I know what you're saying.
All
but
right,
it's still
exactly,
like, it, but reading like a good piece of investigative journalism, you could be entertainment. You could be like, oh yeah, they're busting these guys. You know what I mean? There's like a entertainment aspect to
it. But that's not the norm.
Yeah. No, I agree. So
I mean, like it or not, Trump pimped the media.
Mm-hmm, definitely.
To the end. Mm-hmm. He knew about news ratings. Okay, they have to follow me because ratings are jumping up off the roof.
He's been in the entertainment business longer than anyone covering him. He knew how the game was played. Mm-hmm. But I think now there's been, the media has kind of woke up after the election.
Nah.
Like, you don't think they're like, oh, we helped him?
No, they still follow him like anything.
Yeah.
I mean, his tweets can take off a whole day news coverage.
Yeah.
And they know it's a lie.
Yeah.
He has the press secretary that comes out? Who's the woman that comes out
with Sarah Huckabee Sanders.
Oh, God, boy, what a, I don't want to say it on TV, but I won't say it. But she comes out, and she lies every freaking day.
Mm-hmm.
And she doesn't care. She's there with a straight face, and then they ask her again, and then it's like, oh, you know what.
And everyone knows they're lying. And they're still, it's strange, but the Russia investigation. But then Pence is terrible, too. He believes in, like, gay conversion therapy.
Yeah, he's a quiet devil.
Yeah.
He's a quiet behind the scenes. If y'all get me in there, y'all really going to be in for a surprise.
Mm-hmm.
But then the other party, what do they have? Don't they have nobody?
Jerry Brown.
No, man. Moonbeam ain't going to make it.
He's too...
Gonna,
I know that was his old reputation.
He wouldn't get no Southern votes.
I know.
You think somebody, Mississippi, Georgia?
Well, okay, but...
Pennsylvania, you think they vote for him? They're so confused with...
The main thing I think that he could bring to it would be that he represents, a total ideological shift away from it. So it would be, you know, get, you know, to people
for
who didn't vote
for those that
out.
Are knowledgeable.
Yeah, right. But also... He's like a serious guy who knows what he's doing because he's been doing this a long time,
yes,
too. And I feel like he could, like, land some really pointed insults on Trump that would, like, shut him up and bust him down.
Or else
and then
make
everyone
him explode.
Yeah, right? And then, but, like, then, like, it would be like the emperor has no clothes. Like, I think somebody needs to beat Trump at his own game because he's a bully. So you got to stand up to a bully.
Something that Hillary didn't do.
No.
Because I'll never forget during the debate,
mm-hmm,
when he was like stalking around her,
mm-hmm,
that she did not turn and say something to him.
She was a bad candidate. She didn't get it at all.
Too much baggage.
Yeah.
And she should have had Bill. So you can talk about women and then skip over Bill.
Yeah.
So it's like, how dare you bring that up? You're married to somebody that's like me.
If she had dumped him, though, back in the 90s, which, you know, she had to stay with him for the career, then that would have really helped her nowadays. Like, oh yeah, she had this awful husband who,
but
like,
she loved money too much.
Yeah, she was bad. And she didn't, she could have won if she was just like, guys, I get it. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I'm a mom, I get it.
Right.
If she had just been real at all, but right. It was just so
calculated. Well, some states calculated. She didn't even go to.
She didn't get it.
It was like, I got this already.
Yeah. Well, she was bad and he was bad and he's worse. And but that Russia investigation, I'm telling you, man, that is going to be some juicy stuff.
You believe it? You think so?
Yeah, I'm really hoping. I follow it along. Like, I don't watch like Game of Thrones or anything like that. Like, I follow the Russia investigation.
Really?
Yeah. That's my like serialized entertainment is like the news.
What do you think of Trump's attorney, what was he, mayor of New York? What was he?
Oh, Giuliani.
Yeah.
Interesting. If there's one man for the job, it's Giuliani.
Giuliani's a nutcase.
Yeah, he is.
He's older now, so he's not as sharp as what he used to be.
He wants to help his old buddy from New York out.
And he's used to the spotlight on him.
That's why he's doing it.
Okay, and the cameras are flashing, and he thinks it's his show.
Mm-hmm.
But it ain't his show.
Guys like that, though. Lawyer people are into like the letter of the law and the like semantics of it and stuff like that, and they like they just like it for the competitive aspect. Like Giuliani probably knows Trump is dirty, but he's like, you know, I bet I can do some brilliant legal maneuvering here, and even though everyone knows he's guilty of sin, I can still use the law. Like, that's how he's probably looking at it. Same with OJ's attorneys, not to go back to the juice, but
where,
I mean, come on.
We came back
to.
I always wait, which makes me spin the wheel around,
mm-hmm.
Adam,
mm-hmm.
to where are we at with race relations in America?
Ooh, well.
Why is so much hatred has risen to the top with number 45
mm-hmm.
leading the way to some people?
Mm-hmm.
Where are we at with race relations? Because we can't move forward until we...
Yeah. Well, probably better than where we were 40, 50 years ago when people wouldn't even give race relations like a second thought before the Civil Rights Movement. You know what I mean?
No, like, I don't know you what you mean about, because...
Well, okay, like where people wouldn't be talked about so often. You know what I mean? Where it'd be like, it was like a whole huge struggle.
But,
so things are probably better than...
But when are we going to get past... People? Just talking or avoiding the conversation. You know, it was Obama that made the statement, a teachable moment.
Mm-hmm.
We have teachable moments every day in America, but somehow, some way, somebody got to be the teacher, somebody got to be the student, and it ain't working.
People need to... Integration. Things need to be more integrated, because that's the only way that you, like... Not the only way, like, you can, like... You know, like, no, like, intellectually, like, oh, everyone's equal or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, if you actually, like, have to spend time around, like, we live in Los Angeles here. There's, like, everyone from everywhere here. And it's, like, I think the race relations are pretty good considering about the police and stuff like that.
Depends on where you go.
Sure, but, like, if you're, like, in line at the grocery store, like, everyone could be a different race. And it's just, like, that's just how it is. Like, and everyone's just living their life. And, like,
and but you don't realize that's after you leave California. Because if you go to, like, Iowa or Michigan.
Yeah.
It's like, wow.
Yeah, it's like all... Yeah, I was on tour with... And the singer of my band was black. And then our merch guy is Asian. We were in Tennessee.
Mm-hmm.
And
woo!
Knoxville,
that's a spot.
Yeah, okay, see? So we were just like, you know, oh, Tennessee. So we get there and, like, it's kind of a weird crowd. And the merch guy is like, yeah... Me and David are the only two non-white people here. And I looked around, I was like, oh, that's something that's on my mind when I walk into a place, but ooh, you're right. Like,
because we
gotta be careful, guys.
Because you're white.
Yeah, right?
You don't see that.
Right. And then I was just like, oh, you guys are like, ooh, yeah, like,
but they
this could be a tense situation.
They knew it instantly, right?
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, definitely.
And then it's not just being in a different surrounding, it's the look that comes upon
mm-hmm.
you. When you walk into different stores.
Yeah.
Everything becomes like, you're not us.
But if there were black people walking into the stores all the time, then it would be normal and nobody would give a second. And then I think relations would be better. So
it wouldn't be America. It'd be something different then. I mean, different as how it is now. That we're still talking about Confederate flags and statues. We're still talking about, can you go into Starbucks and have a cup of coffee? Can we use the restroom? No, I don't, no. so many things that we should be so far ahead.
Yeah.
We have this exploration to the heavens. We go to the bottom of the ocean. But then when it comes to folks, people, we're still in that crazy zone.
People just need to meet other people, and that's tough to, like, talk to a stranger or whatever. I get, like, the, like, apprehension of people. Get to know people.
Look at the school system. Mm-hmm. They're, like, totally in shambles.
Yeah.
I don't care what city you go to.
Mm-hmm.
Integrated schools, that's not working well.
People need to, like, actually live, like, with each other. It needs to be, like, even more forced, which is, like, your government can't mandate that. But it literally needs to, like, you need to put everybody in, like, a bowl and, like toss the salad.
Okay, yeah.
Like, have, like, quotas where, like, everyone has to be diverse and everyone has to get along, or else, I think is the only way.
Otherwise, no change. I think that my theory is, okay, when segregation ended,
mm-hmm.
and black folks became a greater part of the middle class,
mm-hmm.
the white folks was already had their little middle class statues set up. Instead of them saying, okay, we've learned from our mistakes, they jumped out and flew mm-hmm. and went to other places and made them segregated.
Yeah. And they didn't learn anything from it.
The hell with y'all middle class, not realizing that if we come together, black, white, brown, Asian, whatever, as middle class people, because we're knowledgeable, we're teachers, we're doctors, we're lawyers, we're just different complexion.
Mm-hmm.
It would be a tremendous force. But that segment of white middle class said, no, we don't want no part of it. So now we find ourselves in this big USS Titanic boat floating around, sinking steadily.
Mm-hmm.
As the rest of the world really advances forward with technology and everything else. So I wonder about the future of America. I wonder even for my grandkids, because unless we become politically active and get some of those old decrepit crud folks out with that Neanderthal type mentality that can't see beyond skin color, we in trouble as a nation, you know. Mm-hmm. They always talk about rule of law, and there's one segment that always wants to create a law that's gonna set me back collectively as a group of people, but advance them in some ways.
Mm-hmm.
They're saturated in the police department, the fire department, all those things that people fought for to say open up the doors. It's a lot better.
Mm-hmm.
You make more money. Everything's better in a sense. So what keeps going wrong that America keeps falling backwards?
You know, if we knew the answer to that, we'd be in a different shape.
Because
I don't know if we that might be a little tall order for the confines of this studio here at KGEM. I don't know if we can solve it.
Well, this is where it begins.
People have to talk. They have to get along with each other. That's the only way.
You said the key thing right there.
But not everyone is extroverted like we are, Ralph. Not everyone wants to just sit down and just, like, talk to someone. And, like,
they don't want to hear the truth?
Yeah. Some people, they don't. They need to, like, open their minds. People can't do it. Some people.
And then there's another part that doesn't hold certain newspapers, certain radio stations, certain TV shows, they don't hold them accountable for presenting truth,
mm-hmm.
facts. They don't. They just let it play out. And then you get that segment that's they're not being deprogrammed, they're continuing the programming.
Yeah.
So eventually everyone's going to be screaming, get out. One last show that's, which is odd to me that they're doing retro for all these shows,
mm-hmm.
but they're not doing many for black shows. But any event, give me your spiel on Roseanne. What's your take on that? She's back.
Great show.
Why do you call it a great show?
So with sitcoms, what I like about that, it's all TV shows, but sitcoms really, it's the chemistry of the cast. And I think that the cast just has really good chemistry, where it is like a family, and they're funny together and stuff. And of all the reboots, I only watched, you know, the first two episodes on the first night. Like, okay. I've seen Roseanne. I know what it's going to be. Yeah, like, whatever. Okay. But I thought it was, you know, it was the closest to back in the old days where it was, like, kind of funny and seemed of the moment.
Mm-hmm. Do you think is really can move forward? Well, 18 million people tune in on, the first episode.
Yeah.
And then the second, I think, quite a bit. I don't know what the numbers went for that. So, can it maintain that?
Well, we're at an interesting point with media where they are only giving us reboots because the risk of rolling out, like, people know that they're going to see Star Wars, even if it's bad. It's like it's guaranteed millions of dollars. So they're only going to give us things that are proven now.
Out of fear?
Out of fear of losing their jobs and making a wrong financial decision. Yeah. So I think that we're just going to keep getting, like in, like, China, for example, they have a lot of TV shows and movies about these, like, Chinese legends that everybody already knows.
Yeah.
Like, the same story everyone already knows, and they just, people are familiar with, oh, let's just make
that. So that's what they stay with.
And so that's where I think we're moving, where there's just, like, a couple of, like, big entertainment properties, most of which will be owned by Disney, and then you have social media for everything else. You have DIY entertainment for everything else.
So that programming will continue.
Yeah, and it'll be even bigger.
That change in everything is not really going to happen? Do you think the movie Black Panther sort of changed the pendulum in a way? Or, that was a long shot that paid off? And
no, because now, okay, that movie's so successful, a lot of those people are going to have careers. Now, longer careers, and they will go on to hire diverse casts and do stuff like that. And then also, there'll be a bunch of things where, like, every other studio is going to be like, oh, we need a black movie now.
Okay.
And then there'll be, that's, you know, a bunch of other jobs for all these other people, and then they get there. Because the thing is, like, I think one of the reasons it's hard for, like, minorities to, like, break into the film business is they don't get the initial shot or whatever. Okay. And then who wants to hire someone with no experience who doesn't know what they're doing? You know, like, you want to just hire this lighting guy who you always work with and you know they can get the job done. So, but now all these people will have experience. So that could, you know, I think it's a good thing. But also, did you see it?
Yeah.
What's up with the accents? Wakanda isn't a real country.
No.
Oh, yeah, this is a movie for black people. You know, we're going to, like, be represented. Let's just make up an African accent now. Come on. Like,
Pan-African. If they pick one country, then that would take something away.
Yeah.
So.
But, like, the lip discs, it was just, like, Pan-African.
Since you playing with the imagination. Mm-hmm. And don't forget, it is a comic book.
Yeah. No, I know.
Okay, so let's just ride with it.
Yeah.
But lighting and cabling and all that is, like, passed down so much. That's like a tight-knitted old boys club.
Yeah, because
you don't just get into that.
Yeah.
I was a filmer up here in the city, and I seen how it worked. I mean, you know, you get, like, 200 people come to town. X amount of person specialized in this and that. How did you get the job? Well, I worked over it over the summer. I didn't get paid, but I showed them I was committed and for real. Okay, so now you in. And then you get in the union. Then those benefits come to you.
Yeah. But it's hard for anybody to do, no matter what your race is. And it's going to be even harder if it's even harder for
some black folks to get up in there.
Because there aren't any other black people. Yeah. So,
So it becomes that constant confrontation of when are we going to get past this.
You gotta just keep pushing it forward. We gotta keep talking about it. Keep like reminding society, like, hey, by the way, things aren't, like, fair yet.
All right.
We have to just keep working. It's like anything else that you want.
I guess the bottom line, Adam, is you can never give up.
Right, exactly.
You must maintain that vigilance that it is not over. Okay. And educate all that you can educate. And periodically pick up a book
Mm-hmm.
That old art form that's probably slowly dying, okay, to read and know history. You would never hear a Jewish person talk about, oh, forget about the Holocaust. We talk about that too much. We make too many Holocaust movies. You ever heard somebody say that?
Nope.
Okay. Some folks say they make too many slavery movies, and then there's some people that don't know nothing about it. But they're telling me their hands of time has moved fast, Adam. So I want to thank you so much for coming here on the show.
Thank you.
Engaging in a dialogue that maybe perk up a few ears and minds out there. That the bottom line is for you to get involved, for you to educate and promote some type of harmony around the people you know and maybe some of the people you don't know or getting to know.